State Feedback Controller Design from the Module 4 of the subject Advanced Control Theory. Faculty taking the session is Professor K. Biju, Head of Department of Electrical and Electronics Engineering, College of Engineering, Moonar. He has got more than 18 years of teaching experience. He did his BTech from RIT Kottayam and MTech from NIT Calicut. He is currently pursuing PhD from NIT Calicut. Welcome, Biju sir.
Thank you. Thank you, Jishan and Akash for the nice introduction and the opportunity. Good afternoon, all dear students. Welcome to today's presentation on the course State Feedback Controller Design and the topic Controllability and Observability. So today in this course, we will be discussing what is State Feedback Controller Design, what is Observer, what is the concept of controllability, observability, and a few applications based on controllability and observability. So I hope this is the fourth module. I hope you have learned pretty well the first three modules of this Advanced Control Theory course. The major topics coming in this first three modules are controllers and compensators, control design using root locus and border plot. These topics are covered in the first two modules. Then the third module is the state space analysis. There are a lot of concepts like state variables, state space modeling, state space modeling for different types of systems, means electrical systems, mechanical systems, electromechanical systems, etc. And I hope you know how to derive a state equation and an output equation if a model or a system is given in terms of transfer function, differential equation, or if it is in the form of an electric circuit, etc. And the solution of state equation can also be obtained using many methods like Laplace transform and all. And I hope you have learned what is state transition metrics also. And these topics are basically the prerequisites for understanding the course on feedback controller design. And I hope you have refreshed these topics which you have learned in the first few modules of this course, so that we will have a better understanding of this today's course. So coming to the introduction of the topic. So we have learned how to design controllers and compensators based on output feedback. So in the first two modules, we have learned how to design a controller or compensator using root locus in the time domain, or using Bode plot in the frequency domain. And in this design, we never thought of whether the system is controllable or not. We took the output variable as a control variable and decided the controller or compensator according to the given required specifications. And at these times, we really didn't think of whether the system is controllable or not. And this control design using root locus was based on dominant faults. As we all of us know, we tried to place the dominant faults on the root locus. That was the approach for designing a control system using the root locus. But if we want to place all the closed loop faults of the system using a state feedback technique, then the system should be controllable. That means if we want to place all the eigenvalues of the metric, then the system should be controllable. And if we want to design an observer for the system, the system should be the concept of controllability and observability. So coming to the notion of controllability and observability, are two very important parameters to be understood before designing a control system using state space model. Controllability basically deals with the possibility of forcing an input, or if the input is able to control the states of a system, or if the input is able to control the states of a system from a particular value at a particular time to a particular value at some after some time interval, then we can say the system is controllable. That's basically the notion of controllability. If a system is uncontrollable, we will not be able to change the states of a system by controlling the input. And the concept of observability is basically whether we are able to observe the state variable, or we are able to estimate the state variable from the measurement of output. So basically, the observability comes with the measurement of output, and the controllability basically deals with the controlling of input. Thus, if the state is not observable, then the controller will not be able to determine the behavior of the system by measuring output. So if we want to understand, or if we want to get a better picture about the behavior of state variables by measuring the output of the system, then the system should be observable. These are the notions of controllability and observability. Now we will discuss the concepts of controllability and observability, each one in detail. So coming to the controllability part. So basically, the concept of controllability here, in the concept of controllability, we are trying to place the faults of the closed loop system by controlling the control signal U, so that we can get any desired value for output from a during an interval of time. So say assume that the state variable initial position was at time t equal to 0. The value was the state variable was at t, and during after some finite interval, say it is changed into x t f. So I will take a two variable system. Say this is a state vector position at a time say t zero. So there are say two control two state variables x one and x two. Now if varying the input, say if I am able to vary the state vector from this position to say some other position, say here. So if I am able to do this by controlling the input, then I can say that the system is controlled. So for moving the state variable from this position to this position, I should be able to control both the state vectors x1 and x2. Then only I will be able to shift the value of the state vector from a particular interval of time t to another particular interval of time t here. Then if it is possible to do this, then I can say that the system is controlled. And if the system is controllable, we can place all the closed loop system as our wish. So coming to the definition of controllability, the system is possible to pass the system from an initial value of x t 0 to any other desired state x t d in a specified time interval of t f minus t 0 by using a control vector. This is a general definition of controllability. And we can test the controllability of a system by using different methods, and generally two methods are being used: Kalman's test and Hilbert test. And Kalman's test is most commonly used, and we will be discussing Kalman's test in this course for testing the controllability of the system. Kalman's test is applied to any form of that is the advantage of Kalman's test. We can apply Kalman's test to any form of metric, whether it is in canonical form or otherwise. But if you want to apply Hilbert test, it should be in the canonical form or Jordan canonical. So in this course, we will be analyzing the controllability of a system by or testing the controllability of a system using Kalman's test. So we will see a few examples for controllability. So I have shown two examples, two engineering systems. So before going to some engineering examples, I can suggest a very simple non-engineering problem. So if we take our class as an example of a system, there is a teacher who is basically the controller. And say there are, assume there are 50 students in the class. There we can assume they are as a state variable. And of course, in a class there may be good students, there may be average students. Some students may not be attending the class well. So if assume there are 25 students who are attending the class well, and if some 25 students they are doing some cross-talking or something else, then I can say that if the teacher is delivering some course, that 25 students who are attending the class is getting the information from the input correctly, and the other 25 students are not getting the information correctly. So if the teacher is able to give some commands to that 25 mischievous students, and if the teacher is able to bring their attention also to the class, and if they also attend the class well, then we can say that by applying some control input, we can attain all the state variables to some design level. This is some say a non-engineering example I have suggested to you for a simple understanding of the concept controllability, and coming back to some engineering examples, so we can see two systems, A and B. In the first system, A, you can see it's a third order system. We know there are, we can see there are three integrated. So it will be, so that you have learned, if there are three integrated, then there will be three state variables for defining the state model of the system. So these are three state variables, and I can control all these state variables using the input control vector to get some state position. So in this system, we can see that it is controllable, because by controlling the input, I am able to control all the three states. We will take this, see this case, case B, and here we can see these two state variables can be controlled by controlling the input vector U, but the first state variable cannot be controlled by controlling the input vector U. So in this case, we can see that out of these three state variables, two state variables can be controlled using the control input vector, and one state variable cannot be controlled. So in this case, we can say it is partially controllable, but not completely controllable. So if a system to be completely controllable, all the state variables should be controllable. This is the basic notion of a controllability. So we will take an electrical circuit as another example. So I have shown two cases, and in the first case, you can see that there is some input, and there is a capacitor, and this is basically, we know it's a first order system, and we know how to select the variables in an electrical circuit, how to define state variables, generally the voltage across capacitor and current related to the state. So here we can see this is a symmetrical network, and we can see all the state four resistors are equal value. So always the voltage across this capacitor will be zero. So irrespective of any values for the input U, the voltage across the capacitor will be zero. So here I cannot control the value of the capacitor or the voltage across the capacitor by controlling the input. So this is this system is not controllable. So this is an electrical circuit example for not controlled. Now the question is, next question is, how can I make this circuit controllable? What is the idea? So if the resistors are different, so in this case all the resistors are equal value. So assume if the resistors are of different values, then definitely there will be some voltage developed across this capacitor. Then by controlling, by varying the power, increasing the voltage or decreasing the voltage, I can increase the voltage or decrease the voltage across the capacitor. So here this state variable will be controlled. So the system can be controlled by varying the state, varying the parameters of it. So take another example. So here there are again two capacitors connected in parallel in series with the resistor. So here also you can see the two resistors are of equal value. So here the voltage across the two capacitors will be equal irrespective of whatever would be the values of the input voltage, because the two resistors connected in series are having equal value. So I can bring the two capacitors to any equal value. Say I want to bring the two voltage across the two capacitors to 5 volts. Then it is possible by controlling the input. But if I want to make say this voltage 5 volts and this voltage 10 ohms, it is not possible by using the circuit because the value of the. So in this case, I cannot get any value for both of these variables. That is not possible. I can get any value for these two variables at a time, but not different ones. So this is a partially controllable system, but not a completely controllable. Again, this can be made completely controllable by varying the values of the system parameters. So I hope you've got a better understanding of what is meant by controllability. Coming to the system, the state space modeling, and you have learned the fundamentals of state space modeling in module 3. Let us consider a system described by the state model x dot equal to ax plus bu and y equal to cx plus u is the first order system, because x dot means the first derivative, and where x is the state vector, u is the control vector, and y is the output vector. And all of us know as A, B, C, D, there are four matrices A, B, C and D, where A will be a square matrix, N by N matrix, B will be a N by M matrix, and C will be a P by N matrix, and D will be a P by M matrix. So coming to the controllability analysis and testing, we shall consider a discrete time system expressed by the state equation x of k plus 1 equal to a into x k plus b into k, where x of 0 equal to x. This is, as all of us know, this is a discrete time representation of the system. In the analog case, it will be x dot. This is a first order system. The continuous time system x dot is replaced by x of k plus 1. So the system controllability, as we discussed, can be roughly estimated as if we are able to transfer the system from any initial state x of 0 equal to x to any desired final state x of k equal to x in a finite time, then we can say that the system is controllable. Now the question to be answered is, can we find a control sequence for u of k, u of 0, u of 1 up to say un minus 1? Such that x of k will be equal to k. So the, basically the question is that by varying for different values of k and for different values of the control inputs u of k, can I get a particular value for x of k, the state? So this is we are going to test. So I assume different values of for k 0, 1, up to n. In this previous equation, in this equation, and we will obtain a new set of equations for different values of starting with say example for k equal to 0, this will be x1, k into x of 0 plus b into u. For k equal to 1, this will be x of 2 equal to a into x1 plus b into u, like that up to from k equal to 0 to up to n, I will get a set of equations. Till a raised to n x of 0 plus a raised to n minus 1. So this will be the first time will be a raised to n x of 0. Second time will be a raised to n minus 1 below 0. Till the last time will be, because we can see the last time will be for x of 2. The last time is b into u of 1. So the last time for x of n will be b of u into n minus 1. So these set of equations can be converted into a matrix like this. X of n minus a raised to n. I am bringing this time x of 0 time also the state, this state time also to the x of n, and keeping all other times the right, then x of n minus a raised to n x of 0 equal to, you get a matrix like this b a b a raised to n minus 1 b into this will be this u times will be appearing as a whole matrix from u of n minus 1, u of n minus 2, up to u of 0. The last one will be, obviously, the last time will be u of 0. So here we have to note that this matrix, this b, a, b, a raised up to a raised to n minus 1, b matrix will be a square matrix. And we will see that later how it becomes a square matrix. And we can call this matrix as a controllability matrix. And it is generally denoted by the symbol C of C, controllability matrix. And the important concept is that if the controllability matrix is non-singular, non-singular means determinant is non-singular, then the above equation produces a unique solution for the given input. So the concept is if this controllability matrix is non-singular, that means the determinant of that controllability matrix is not zero, then this set of equations will be a unique solution for the value of x. And this matrix, this and that matrix we are mentioning as this QC, this row matrix, we denote by QC. So QC into this column matrix, this input vector is a column matrix. So this QC, which is a square matrix, into the column matrix is equal to x of n minus a raised to n. Just for any value of x, the above expression determines the input sequence that transfers as a state, initial state x from a desired state x in n steps. That means using n steps we can bring the initial state of the system from say x of 0 to any final state, say x of n, in a particular duration, say using say n steps for this discrete time. Follows that the controllability condition in this case is equivalent to, as I explained in the previous slide, that it is equal to known singularity of the controllability matrix. So the condition is that only the condition is that the controllability matrix QC should be non singular. In that case, we will get a unique solution for that x of n or basically x of that n. So in general, when the input and one more point, this input vector u of n, this input vector can take any dimension. But we are taking as a general case. In a general case, when the input vector is of dimension r, that means it may not be a one dimensional input vector. It can be two dimensional if there are two inputs. Because we can use that is a drawback of transformation modeling. Transformation can be only applied to single input, single output system, but state space modeling can be applied to multiple input systems also. So there can be more than one input. So input can be multi-dimensional. So we have seen UK with a dimension r, then the procedure again leads to this our equation, and the controllability matrix QC will be this. And the controllability matrix in that case will be, for a general case, the dimension will be n into r dot n. So if this r is 1, that means a single input, then it will be a square matrix, as I mentioned. So if it is a, say, if it is a two dimensional, that means if there are two inputs, then it will, then the u will be a two dimensional. In that case, it won't be a square matrix. Then in that case, if it is a two dimensional inputs, in that case, the order of that matrix, controllability matrix, will be n into 2n. That means it will be a rectangular matrix rather than a square matrix. Then the system of n algebraic equations in n dot r, then in that case there will be n dot r unknown for the n dimensional vector component. So we will get a matrix where the only difference is that the QC matrix will be changed with the rectangular. So in general, we will have a solution for any x if and only if the matrix QC has a full rank. That means we are all familiar with the concept of rank. That for a matrix, the rank of the matrix will be n if the matrix is non-singular. So that we have already explained the notion of controllability, that for this equation will have a unique solution if this controllability matrix is non-singular. That means if the matrix is non-singular, I can say that the rank of the matrix is n, where n is the order of it. So this is the criteria. By checking the rank of the matrix, we can arrive at a conclusion that whether the whether the system is controllable or not from the information of the controllability matrix. So in nutshell, we are concluding the controllability test matrix using the Kanman's method. So we have taken a state equation x dot equal to x plus b. For this system, the controllability test matrix we have derived as QC equal to BAB, A square B, up to A raised to n minus 1 B. Where n is the order of the system and equal to the number of, as we know how to define state variables in a state model, it will be equal to the number of for order of the system. That means for a second order system, there will be two state variables. For a third order system, there will be three state variables. So the system is completely state controllable. QC is equal to n. That means it is an order of it. Or it is equal to the rank of it. So the system is completely controllable if the rank of the system is equal to the order of it. That means it should be non-singular. The controllability test matrix should be non-singular. In that case, the system is controllable. So the notion of controllability and controllability test matrix is clear to you, and as I have said earlier, the controllability matrix is a square matrix if the system is single input only, and it will be a rectangular matrix, then the size will be n into n instead of n into n, for which the system has multiple inputs. So for a single input system, the controllability test matrix will be a square matrix, which is easier to solve. And for a multiple input system, the controllability test matrix will be a rectangular matrix, where we will have to have a different approach that we will see better. The controllability test matrix is a square matrix, the controllability can be easily checked by finding the difference. If QC is not equal to 0, that means non-singular, And the rank of the control system and the system is completely state controlled. You see, is equal to 0, we know the rank is not equal to n and the system is not. So this is the idea, or this is how we will test whether the system is controlling. So if the controllability matrix is a square matrix, what we will do is that we will simply find the determinant of the matrix, and if the determinant is non-zero, then the system is controllable. And if the system is determinant is zero, then the rank is not equal to n, and the system is. So then very easily we can test the controllability. So hope the concept of controllability is understood. Now we will go to the concept of observability. And as I said earlier, the observability basically deals with the measurement of output. That means by measuring the output, if you are able to get an estimate of the state variable, then we can say that the system is observable. So in the observability test, we can find whether the system is observable or measurable by measuring the output. The concept of observability is useful in solving the problem of reconstructing unmeasurable state variables from measurable. So if the state variables are unmeasurable, I am not able to directly measure the state variable. And in that case, if the output is measurable, and I will measure the output, and from the output measurement, I will estimate the state variable. This is basically the concept of observability. And these types of and the observers we place for this purpose are known as observer. And in the control system, the observer design of observer is another area, and the design of observer is beyond our scope of this course, and we will not be going into the details of design of observer or not, but just to the notion of observability, that is mainly observability. So the definition of observability: a system is said to be completely observable if for every state x of t, or if every state x of t can be completely identified or estimated by measuring the outputs by t over a finite interval of time. So if we are able to estimate the state of a system by measuring the output variable, then we can say that the system is observable. The system is completely observable if we are able to estimate all state variables from the output. And we can say the system is partially observable if a few of the state variables can be estimated from the output. And again, we have a test for observability. Again, the Kalman and Gilbert also have suggested methods for testing the observability of the system. And in this course, we will be learning how to test the observability of a system using Kalman. So we will coming to a few examples for explaining the concept of observability. Before coming to an engineering problem, again I am going back to our non-engineering problem of class. I am drawing your attention again to our class. There is a teacher, there are a few students, and so in the classroom the teacher is basically the input, and we can say in the classroom the students are there. I can define as state variable. And in the observability test, we measure the output. So I don't know directly how the teacher has taught some course, and I don't know whether all the students have understood it properly. So I need some method for measuring the output. So how can I measure the output for that class? Normally the output of a class is normally measured by conducting some tests, and I conduct some tests to measure the output. And I assume in a class of 50 students, 45 students attended that test, and 5 students could not attend the test due to some medical reason, some fever or not. And 45 students attended the test and evaluating the answer sheet. So somebody will be having very good mark, above 80% mark. Somebody will be having some 50 to 80% mark. So from that mark distribution, I can have an estimate of that student. That means the state variable of the class. But the 5 students have not attended the class. So how can I measure that? How can I get the estimate of that 5 students? Not possible. So in this case, I got an estimate of 45 students, but I didn't get an estimate of 5 students. So I can say the system is not completely observable, but it is partially observable. So this is basically the notion of observability. So I will bring your attention to some engineering problems as well for getting a better notion of observability. So consider this system, first system. There are three state variables, there are three integrated, so it's a third order system. So there are three state variables, and this is the input and this is the output. And by measuring the output from the system, by measuring the output, I can get an estimate of this state variable and this state variable. So in this case, I can say that the system is controlled. Why? Because by measuring the output, why? I will get an estimate or idea about all these three state variables. So I can say that this system A is observable. Let us check what is the state variable or what is the case with the system B. So in this case, from the measurement of output, I can measure the state of this state variable and this state variable also. But what about this first state variable? I cannot measure the state variable or I cannot get an estimate about this state variable by measuring the output. So in this case, we can say that it is not completely observable because I get two estimates of two state variables, but I am not getting any idea about this state variable by the measurement of output. So in this case, we can say that the system is not completely observable. So this is a case of completely observable system. Case of a not completely not observable. Let us take another example for an electrical system. There is an input, a voltage U, and the output is measured across here. And there is a capacitor. This is obviously a first order system. And we know how to define the state variable for an electrical system. So there is a capacitor. So the voltage across the capacitor will be the state variable. And what about the voltage across this capacitor? Obviously, it will be zero as it is a symmetrical structure with all the resistors values here. So irrespective of the value of Y, say if the voltage is 10 volts. So here it also it will be because it is connected in parallel. The voltage is 10 volts. This is also 10 volts. So the voltage across here it will be zero. So assume it is 20 volts. So here the voltage will be 20 volts. Again, because this is a symmetrical network, the voltage is zero. So for 10 volts output voltage and 20 volt output voltage, the voltage across the capacitor. So I cannot get an estimate of the voltage across the capacitor by measuring the output. So in this case, we can say that it is not observable because I am not getting an idea about the voltage across the capacitor by measuring the output. So this is a case of a system which is not observable. Now, how can I make another question? How can we make this system observable? What is the idea? So instead of equal values, if these are of different values, so obviously there will be some voltage across the capacitor. So in that case, by varying the voltage U, we will get different voltages across the system, and accordingly, the voltage across the capacitor will be varied. And by measuring the voltage output voltage, I will get some idea about the voltage across the capacitor, and that can be made. So by varying the system, by controlling the system variables, I can make the system observable. The unobservable system is an observable. So take another system. So there is an input, output. There are four state variables. X1, X2, X3, X4. There are four state variables. So take first state variable X1. So this is so by measuring the or by controlling the inputs, I can control this state variable. And by measuring the output, I can get an information about this state variable. So I can say that this state variable is controllable as well as observable. So take the next state variable. So by controlling the input, I can control this state variable. But by measuring the output, I cannot get an estimate of this state variable. So this state variable is controllable but not observable. Take this state variable case. I cannot control this state variable by controlling the input. So this state variable is not controllable. But I will get an estimate or idea about this state variable by measuring it. So this state variable is not controllable but observable. So take this state variable. So I cannot control the state variable by controlling the input. Also, I cannot get an estimate of the state variable by measuring the output variable. So this state variable is, so this state variable is neither controllable nor observable. So in this system, we have some state variables which are, some state variables are controllable and observable. Some state variables are controlled but not observable. Some state variables are observable but not controllable. Some state variables are neither controllable nor observable. So this is the case where all these cases appear. So in this case, we can see that, so what is the total controllability of your observability as a whole? So for a system to be controllable, all the state variables will be controllable. Similarly, for the system to be observable, all the state variables will be observable. But in this case, all the state variables are controllable, or not all the state variables are observable. So this is a case of not controllable and not observable, completely not controllable. Okay. So hope the concept of controllability and experience is clear. Now we will take the discrete time, or consider a discrete time system for analyzing the observability of the system, and we will try to derive an observability test metric from the discrete time system. So consider a linear time invariant discrete time system, x plus v in the state equation x of k plus 1, k in the xk plus v in the k layer x of 0 equal to x, with the output measurement y of k equal to c in the x of k, where c is the metric. So in this case, the natural question to be asked is, can we learn everything about the dynamic behavior of the state variable defined in this situation by using only information from the output variable, the second equation? So by measuring the output variable, can I get all the information about this state variable? This is a fundamental question to be asked. And that is possible, we can say that this system is successful. Otherwise, the system is unsuccessful. So if we know x, then the recursion of the state equation, this state equation, by using the recursion, if we know x, by using recursion of this state equation, apparently gives the complete knowledge about the state variables at any time, discrete time. So for starting with the k equal to 0, 1, 2, etc., for any discrete values of k, I can get the state values as well as output values. That's the only thing that we have to determine from the state measurements is the initial state vector x of 0. So from the output measurement, we should get the state vector information. Since the n-dimensional state vector x of 0 has n unknown components, it is expected that n measurements are sufficient to. So there are n unknown components. Since there are n unknown components, n measurements will be sufficient to get an idea about the state vector. So take k equal to 0, 1 up to n minus 1 in the above equation, you get it. So from taking k equal to 0 up to n minus 1 in this above equation, you will get a following sequence. So y of 0, so for k equal to 0, y of 0 equal to c of x 0, for k equal to 1, y of 1 equal to c of x 1. So this continuing up to y of n minus 1 equal to c of x of n minus 1, and up to substituting this, this will come up to c of a raised to n minus 1. Okay. And this equation can be converted into a metric form of y of 0, y of 1, y of 2, up to y of n minus 1. And this metric will be E, it's a column metric. In the case of observer, it was a raw metric. And here it is coming as a column metric. There it was A and B, here it is C and B. That is the difference. E, A, 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 So we know from linear algebra that system of linear algebraic equations with n unknowns, the above equation has a unique solution if and only if the system metric has a random. So this system will have a unique solution if the system metric, if the system metric will have a rank n. That means if the system metric has to have a rank n, means this system this should be known. We call it as observability metric, and the rank of this observability metric should be equal to the order of the system. Then in that case, it will be non-singular. That means the rank of this observability metric should be equal to n, where n is the order of the system. The initial condition x is determined is the so-called observability metric. We denote the observability metric by the symbol Q of Q O. This is a column metric, and if this column metric has a rank n, then the system is observable. That means the Q of 0, the rank of Q of 0 equal to n, which is the order of the system, or equal to 1, then we can say it is observable. So, it should be non singular. If it is singular, it is 0, and this condition is observable. Then, concluding that the conveyance method observability test metric, so we have considered a state model, x float equal to a x plus b, y equal to x plus b. For the system, the observability test metric is c0 equal to c of b, a raised to t, c of t, a t square, up to a raised to t, n minus 1, c. So the first time will be c of c raised to t. Why I have written like this, C of T, A, T is transpose. So, because because originally this observability matrix is a column matrix. I have written it in a raw form by writing it as sum. Hope that I it is understood why it is transposed from here. Originally it is a column matrix. I have written in a raw form as a raw single row by writing all the transpose for all the entries. So C transpose, A transpose, C transpose like that. And the last time will be A transpose, C transpose. They release the order of the system. In this case, the system is completely observable. The rank of the observability matrix is very simple to get. So, hope the notion of observability is understood and how to test observability if the system is given in Kalman's test. Basically, what we have to do is that we have to, from the system model, we have to arrive the observability test metric, and from the test metric, we have to find the rank of the system. And this simple method for this is a square metric, and it is very easy. We may not find the rank of the system, we simply find the decrement of the system. And if the decrement is not zero, that means it is non singular, and in that case, it will be equal to. The rank would be equal to the order of the system, and in that case it will be otherwise not. So, and we will see if it, for a multi-input system where the observability test matrix again will not be this is for a single input system, this observability test matrix will be a square matrix. But for a multi-input system, it will not be a square matrix. In that case, again we have to have a different matrix. So we will see a problems of the numerical input system. So first we shall consider a system with a single input. You can see that the order of the system is equal to 1, 1, 2, 1, -2. The A matrix, which is a square matrix, x1, x2 plus it's a D matrix. 0, 1 is a column matrix, and this is D. So we will check whether the system is observable or not. And what is the observability test matrix for this? It will be what will be the observability test metric? EAB up to A raised to n minus 1. What is n here? 2. So A raised to n minus 1 is 2 minus 1 A1. AD. So we will end up with BAB. So only two entries will be there. BAB. And say if n is 3, so then it will be A raised to n minus 1 will be 2. Then one more time will be A square B will also come. So for a 2 by 2, second order system, there will be only 2 times BAB. And this is from the system, given system, we will get that A and B. So we can see that we need only E and A information. We need only two matrices for finding the observable controllability of the system. We need only B and A. We don't need C or D matrix. So we will get from the state equation. We don't need output equation here. We need only state matrix, state equation, because we need only B and D. So from this matrix, this is A matrix. So we can calculate the AB. So we have to multiply A and B to get the AB value. AB. A is B, B is C. So multiply. So we will get AB matrix. So now you have to put this AB value also in this matrix. So B is 6, B is already 0, 1. Then AB is another column, is 1 minus 1. So this is the new control entry matrix. Now what you have to do is that this is a square matrix. So simply you find the decrement of it. So what is the determinant of this? Determinant is minus 1. So minus 1 means it is not equal to 0. That means it is non-singular. And here, in this case, the rank will be equal to the order of the system, and it is a controllable. So this is a case of a system which is controllable. So we will take another example, another second order system, and ask A, this will be A, this will be B. And the controllability test matrix will be BAB. So again, this is the second order system, two entries. So we will compute AB and we will see QC. And we can see, we will find the determinant. This is QC matrix. So obviously, we can say that determinant is zero because a row is completely zero. So the what is the problem? So it is singular. So the problem is the rank is not equal to this. Here the rank will be 1. The rank is not equal to the order of the system, and so the system is not completely controlled. So this is a case of not completely controllable system, and the previous case was a completely controllable. Now we shall consider a third order system. It is three state variables x1, x2, x3, a single input, third order single input system. And so A matrix will be a third order matrix, column matrix, again we have to. So here, as I said, the QC matrix will have one more value, A square B, because A raised to n minus 1, n is 3, so A square will also. So the controllability matrix will be B, A, B, A square B. So we are here, we have to compute A, B and A square B. So first we will compute A, B, then we will compute A square B. A square will be A, will be A into A, B. So A multiply A, B, then we will get the QC matrix. And you find the discriminant. This is the QC matrix, is the square matrix. So simply find the discriminant. So this is one. This is again. This is non-singular. Determinant is not equal to zero, so non-singular. So in this case, the rank will be equal to the order of the system. So the system is completely controllable. So this is also a controllable. Now we will take a multi-input system. Here this we can see the order is three, but see the difference here. So instead of earlier in the previous all the previous cases. This input matrix was a column matrix, single column. That means only one, the order was, column order was only one. Here you can say it is two. Okay. So this is a multi-input system. Now we see how to evaluate the probability for a multi-input. So A, B, A and B. So we will find the third order system. So B, A, B, A square B. So we will compute A, B, A square B. So we can see that A square B. So see the controllability matrix. It's not a square matrix. So, because it is B, it's not a square matrix. Now, how to, so because we cannot take the determinant, then how to proceed? We'll see. So, here what you have to do is that you take any 3 by 3 matrix from here, which is only thing is that all the entries should not be 0 or row wise or column wise. You can take any 3 like this. And you find the determinant 1. So no problem. Now that what you have to do is that so the controllability matrix is QC. So you have to take QC transpose also and multiply QC into QC transpose. So this is QC, this matrix is QC transpose. Multiply and you will get the square matrix. Now you find the determinant of the square matrix. So we have determinant QC. So this is not zero, that means non singular. So rank of the system will be 23. System is completely complete. Now we will take a one or two examples for an observation. So a second order system, a single input system, second order system. So we know for a second order system, the matrix for a matrix, the observability matrix is E, C, A, C up to C raised to N minus 1. So here N is 2. So C raised to N minus 1 means C, it will end up with. So only two entries, C and C A. And basically it is C, C A column matrix. And not to write in a row form, you will write as C, C, A transpose. Okay. So we will find, we have C matrix, this is C matrix and this is A matrix. Because Y is C, A, so this is C matrix. So we have C matrix, A matrix, so we can find C, A. So we will get C, A. So what you have to write, that zero matrix, C matrix, C matrix is 1, 0 and C, A matrix is 1, 1. And you have to find the determinant. This is 1, this is non-singular. So the rank of the matrix will be equal to the order of the system and the system is in this case is open. Now we will consider a third order system, okay, these two variables. So obviously here it will be C A square, A raised to N minus 1, N is 3, so C A square. So C, C A, C A square. So we have to find, compute here C A square also. So we will find C A, C A square. So we are getting a 3 by 3 matrix of observability matrix. So again a square matrix. So we will compute the determinant. So here we can see that determinant is 0. So it is the rank is not equal to the order of the system, it's a singular matrix. So in this case the rank is just 2, it is not equal to the order of the system. So in this case system is not completely complete. So now we will take a fourth order system. Again I have shown this is similar to third order, this is a fourth order system. So here one more entry will be there, AQ. So C, C, A, C, S, A cube. So you have to compute A cube also. And you find the determinant. It's a 4 by 4 matrix. And if it is, we are getting the determinant as 1, that means the rank of the matrix is equal to the order of the system. So this is a case with a multi input system, two input. So this is the C matrix. So again, this is the fourth order system, so up to A cube. So you have to find CA, CA square, CA cube. And so since it is a multi-input system, you will not be a square matrix. So you have to repeat the earlier procedure in the case of observability. So you have to take a 4 by 4 matrix from that and find the determinant. So we are getting minus 1. So it is not 0. So what you have to do is that you have to multiply Q0 into Q0 transpose. It's into this transpose. So you will get a square matrix. Then find the determinant of the square matrix. It is non 0. It is, so in this case, the rank is equal to the order of the system and this case is the complete control. So we will take a case with the both controllability and observability. For a given system, we will check controllability and observability for a single system. The third order system, we will check controllability and observability. So why the third order system? Why this is A matrix, this is C matrix, this is B matrix. This is A matrix, this is B matrix, this is C matrix. So we can, so for the third order system, the observability matrix will be, controllability matrix will be B, A, B, A square. This will compute, this is the controllability matrix. And then we find the determinant, this is equal to the rank of the system, so system is controllable. Similarly, we will develop the observability matrix also. C transpose, A transpose, C transpose, we will find this. And we are getting an observability matrix. Again, we will find the determinant of the system, this is equal to the rank of the system. So the system is controllable. So this system is, so for this given system is both controllable as well as the major reference to I suggest for learning this topic is model control engineering data, the control system, control foundation. These are the good books for also.
Yes, for the first question, from Midun Murali. Please explain controllability and observability of a continuous time system, if possible, with a problem.
The concept of controllability and observability is same for continuous time system as well as discrete time system. I took an example for a discrete time system. Same system we can take or convert into a continuous time system that I was mentioning, that x of k plus 1 representation first order system in the discrete domain. The analog representation for continuous time system is x naught. Using that also, using that continuous time domain also, you can derive the same matrix for continuous, for controllability as well as observability. You can derive the same matrix, and using that Kalman step, I explain, you can test the controllability and observability of the continuous time domain.
Okay, next question from Anjali. For observability, we didn't use y equal to cx plus du. We took y equal to cx.
Yes, good question. A good understanding of the code. Generally, the output matrix is the general representation is y equal to cx plus du. But generally, most of the systems, it will be that y equal to cx plus du will be limited to y equal to cx plus du, because rarely that d matrix will come in the system. For normally the input will be processed using the same engine. Some process will be happening inside the system, and the output will be generated depending on the input and the state rate. So normally the input is not directly connected to the output. So the input will be processed using the state variable, and the output will be developed according to that process. That is why the D is not coming in the system directly in most of the cases. And the D comes when input is directly connected to the system. That is very high. That is why when we take some examples, general examples, that D is. That is the reason why we took it as Y instead of Y equal to CX plus D also. So that be clear, the answering should be clear, because D also can come.
Hello.
Okay.
Adutha, next question from Achyudan Nadungattu. How can we implement this in a digital controller? For example, a microcontroller.
In the case of digital implementation, we have to convert all this into digital domain. So basically, we can have two implementations, continuous analog implementation and digital implementation. In the case of digital implementation, we should convert all the analog system into digital. That discrete phenomenon. Basically, this discrete, I took an example for a discrete system, x, a plus 1. The analog domain is x dot k for a first order system, x dot k. The digital implementation is x, k plus 1. Only for if we are planning a control system in the digital domain, instead of going for the continuous control variable like x dot over x double dot, we should convert all the continuous variables into samples. X of k plus 1, then in that case, the state variables will be, or derivatives of state variables will be x of plus, xk plus 1, xk plus 2, as I mentioned. So in that case, that the state variables will take some discrete values, like k equal to 0, 1, 5. And using that type of representation, so instead of a continuous variable t for any value for a continuous variable, the continuous time system, t can take, the variable will be, the control variable will be time, there t can take any value from 0 to 1. But in the case of discrete, instead of, it is not continuous. Instead of that, it will be time interval, and k equal to 0, then next we will be basically taking samples. Counting k equal to 0. After that, it will be k equal to 1. In between, there will be a counter. So, first sample, second sample, third sample. Like. So, that is how we are to do it.
Hello, sir. Next question from Arun. Is matrix B the first column and matrix A B the second column of the composite matrix?
Yes. I demonstrated it in some example form. Say, second order system. There will be, in general, we need A and B matrix. So, B matrix we can directly write there. And because B matrix is a column matrix, and when we compute A B matrix, then again it will be a column matrix. So, B A B, that is how B A B will become a 2x2 matrix. Because B is a column matrix, then we compute A B, then again it is a column matrix, right? Because B is a column matrix. So, that will be a 2x2 matrix. So, both B and A B matrix are column matrix. It was demonstrated in that application.
Okay, sir. Same person has asked one more question. In the numerical problem of controllability, why the transpose of matrix Q multiplied with matrix Q? Or is it clear?
Yes, the question is clear to me. It's a case of multi-input system. So in that case, we need for finding the determinant, we need a square matrix. But for multi-input system, the matrix will be a rectangular matrix. We have to convert that rectangular matrix into a square matrix. So for that, we are multiplying that matrix with the transpose of that matrix itself. So that when we multiply that with the rectangular matrix, when we multiply the transpose of that rectangular matrix, we can convert it into a square matrix, and then we can find the determinant of the system, and thereby finding the observability. That is the reason for doing that multiplication of that matrix in the transpose, for making that a square matrix. Thank you. So thank you, students, for the patient listening and for the nice questions being asked. And thank you, Jishin and Akol Atap team for the technical support. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.